Good morning. May it please the Court, my name is Gabriel Chin. I'm here with Ann McClintock. I'd like to reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal. I'm not going to address the sentencing issues raised on appeal unless the Court has questions. Christopher Jackson was the charming, well-dressed salesperson in a real estate business. According to the government, he was not in charge of buying, developing, managing, or selling the real estate portfolio at issue. Instead, he was the rainmaker, the closer. The indictment charged that Mr. Jackson received money from investors but did not send it to the real estate companies.
Help me on something here. As I understand it, he brought in around $10 million and about $2.5 million, and it was proof to have been invested in real estate. Is that right?
Yes, Your Honor. Those facts could.
Now, the government analogized it to Ponzi, but he didn't buy any of those postal coupons at all. He just used new investors' money to pay old investors so that it looked like it was working. And if you had a company like, say, a serious long-term brokerage house, they might have a high overhead and high salaries for the management, and maybe somebody had put in $10 million and some figure less than $10 million but more than $2.5 million would wind up going into the investment pool. And I don't think, I don't know, maybe the government would charge it as fraud, but I doubt it. There's got to be some point between zero and all the money going into investments where it's a phony operation, and I can't tell exactly what the rule is.
I think the rule, Your Honor, is that there has to be some investigation of how much was actually invested, and that's what was not done in this case.
Well, I don't care about investigation at this point. I care about testimony, evidence.
That's right. There was absolutely no evidence.
Well, I saw it with respect to the Mr. Jackson's specific club, the Genesis Innovations, that the government put on evidence that there was, as Judge Kleinfeld said, $10 million in. $2 million went into real estate investments. $2 million went to pay prior investors, and then he took out some amount for his own use. So as I understand your theory as well, possibly $8 million was invested somewhere else, but there wasn't any evidence placed in evidence on that. Am I right with your theory?
No, Your Honor, that's not my theory. My theory is that because money is fungible and because we have an entity here with a number of people, according to the government's witnesses, 100 to 150 people working in this.
Is that in the Genesis Innovations Club? Was that the one run by your client?
No, Your Honor, but the superseding indictment pleads and the government's evidence proves that this was, for practical purposes, a single entity that was controlled by Mr. Alden. And all of the entities, like many corporations, although there were different subsidiaries, they worked together as a single unit, and Mr. Bolton was at the head of this operation. For practical purposes, there was no separation between the entities, and Mr. Bolton would say to Mr. Jackson, for example, to send $100,000 to someone else for...
So help me understand what the theory is. You repeat frequently in the briefs that money is fungible, which no doubt is correct. But what is your theory about why the fact that only $2 million of the $10 million investment went into real estate doesn't matter for our purposes?
Because if there was other money, which there clearly was,
No other money, meaning what? That other investors had put money into other parts of the business?
Exactly.
So if other investors put money in other parts of the business, why does that make a difference with respect to these investors with their $10 million?
Because the key other investor was Mr. Bolden. And if Mr. Bolden put in $25 million of his own money to capitalize this operation and had other people, which the government's witnesses said he was very wealthy and had a large portfolio of real estate that he put towards this business, if pieces of that were later sold out to other investors, that's perfectly legitimate. It's a common business practice.
But help me understand. So I invest $10 million with Mr. Jackson, and then that's not used for investment purposes. And then there's another account with my name on it that with my $10 million. Is that your theory?
Thank you, Your Honor. It's a great question that gets right to what I'm trying to say. You give $10 million to Mr. Jackson. Mr. Bolden has put $10 million of his real estate into this company and taken back a note for $10 million.
Well, so is that my $10 million as an investor?
And Mr. Bolden at any time can say, hey, I want my $10 million back, in which case the real estate's going to have to be sold to pay the note. But this is a real estate business. We don't want to sell the real estate until we're ready to sell the real estate. Now we have $10 million from you, and we can take that money and use it for whatever purposes Mr. Bolden says, and that is that keeps the $10 million in the parcels of real estate that we want to keep. And so to that extent.
For my purposes, is the investor of $10 million, is my name on their piece of real estate, or is it Mr. Bolden's name? Because I put $10 million in the company, and I understood from Mr. Jackson that it was all going into real estate investments.
That's correct, but it's a borrower-creditor relationship. It's not an equity investment. So, yes, now your $10 million is used to finance this 123 Main Street. Now we don't have to sell 123 Main Street and liquidate it to pay Mr. Bolden or anyone else.
Bolden had a demand note.
What I'm saying is,
did Bolden have a demand note?
I don't know.
Oh, you said he put $10 million in.
This was a hypothetical. I beg your pardon, Your Honor. This is a hypothetical, Judge Okuda said. So this is how it could work. This is how, as in Davis versus Connecticut Community Bank, how it's weird. Wait a minute. Why is money coming from Judge Okuda and going to other investors? That must mean it can't be being invested in real estate, and that's not the case based on the way real estate finance works, which is
on something. Use the word investor and investment, and I'm a little confused there. I've seen situations where it's a limited partnership, so you put in money and it gets invested, and I've seen all sorts of other things. I had the impression, but I never saw an exhibit, which I could have missed in the voluminous papers, that shows exactly how the money goes in. It looked to me, from the words describing it, as though people would put $100,000 in and get a promissory note for $100,000.
That's correct, Your Honor.
Is that the case in all these people put money in and they get a note?
My understanding is that these were really, yes, that there were notes in exchange for money, and those notes were backed by real estate.
So the customers don't invest in real estate. What they do is they lend money to the enterprise.
That's correct. They lend money to be invested in real estate. And
they lend money to the enterprise, and the enterprise invests in real estate to make money in order to pay them back with interest.
Exactly.
Is that the arrangement?
Exactly. Exactly.
I'm thinking that's banking without a banking license. I mean, when I deposit money in the bank, they don't hold it in a box for me. They do whatever they please, give themselves salaries and airplane trips and retreats and whatever they want, as long as they pay me back with interest when I come in to make a withdrawal.
That's my understanding.
Is this arrangement similar?
It is, except I agree with the government that there was a promise that this money would go to real estate investment in one way or another. And that, so I do think that $10.3 million has to have been invested in real estate in one way or another. And that could mean buying out the positions of prior investors.
That can't be true, that the whole $10 million was invested in real estate, because they've got a very high overhead. Well, basically, what your fellow got, Jackson, is commissions to beat the band on his sales, enough to buy a fancy car and do all these other expensive things.
Well, my point, Your Honor, about
this. If you get a high overhead, it wouldn't be anybody's business, and I'm trying to figure out what the difference is.
The difference is that, according to the government's witnesses, Mr. Bolden had a very substantial real estate portfolio, which in one way or another, could have financed this operation. The other thing is that, again, because this entity is an entity, notwithstanding the separate units, there is absolutely no reason that Mr. Bolden can't tell Mr. Jackson, don't bother to send me the $100,000. You use it for business expenses. Don't bother to send me $100,000. This is your commission based on whatever set of deals that you've done. And Mr. Bolden is responsible for managing the real estate portfolio and keeping the records. Nobody claims that Mr. Jackson, his job is to go to restaurants and talk to people, which is in many, many fields, including our own, a recognized function.
Now that we're clear on what it is the so-called investors actually being lenders. I'm wondering if the case is like if your workmate, somebody at the office says, could you please help me? I've got a whole lot of money due on my car payment. I'm going to lose my car if I don't make the payment. Would you lend me $500? And so you lend him $500, and actually his car payment's fine. He doesn't use the $500 for a car payment. He uses it for a very fancy date. And I think that's the fraud we're talking about here, isn't it?
I do think that there is an obligation of the borrower to use the money to further the thing that they promised to do. But in this case, as the evidence shows, Mr. Jackson took in something like $10.3 million, and Tara Cook, the government's key witness, testified that from the entity as a whole, at least $14 million went to KOA Weaver and Sycamore Ventures, the real estate entities that he promised to send them to. So unless we say that only his specific dollars count, not the ones that he might have given to another entity and from there went to KOA Weaver or Sycamore Ventures, unless money is not fungible, then I don't see how it can be said that what he promised
was there testimony about how much total went into KOA or other real estate investments?
Yes. Tara Cook testified that something like $14 million altogether went to, and this is at page 23 of our brief, referring to excerpts of record 280. And other than that, $14 million.
It couldn't have all been from Jackson's 10.
No.
Systematically,
Tara Cook said $14 million.
Okay, can we tell how much of the $10 million that Jackson raised went into real estate?
Because money is fungible, Your Honor. No.
I don't care about the particular dollar bills that he raised. There's no question you're right about money being fungible. What I care about is, in total, how much of that got invested in real estate.
I don't think we can, since Mr. Bolden asked Mr. Jackson to use his money for various purposes related to the operation of the business. And since the government's own witnesses and evidence suggested that Mr. Bolden had substantial resources that he could put into the business, I think it's possible to say that what he proposed to do didn't in fact happen. With the court's permission, I'm going to reserve the rest of my time.
Thank you. We'll hear from the government.
Good morning. May it please the court. My name is Jared Dolan. I'm an assistant United States attorney in Sacramento. I was also one of the trial counsel below. This case is almost entirely controlled as to the sufficiency issue by United States versus Nevels. And the theories advanced by the defense today are aptly characterized as hypothetical because they either have no basis in the evidence or to the extent.
Help me on something.
Yes.
Even though the briefs talk about investment, what it turns out to be is loans, promissory notes, and security. And the question would seem to be false statements used to obtain the loans. And if I got that right so far?
Partially in the government's view. The reason why I say that is the way the promissory notes were phrased. That was kind of the legal way that it was signed off on by investors.
So far, then, it's just like putting money The bank does whatever it pleases, whenever it pleases with the money. It doesn't have to buy other people's mortgages or build shopping or loan money for building shopping centers, or it can use it all on corporate jets if it wants, as long as it pays back the demand loans that the depositors make to the bank when they make demands.
The reason why I said partially, Your Honor, is because while that was what the contract said, that's not how both the investors talked about it during their testimony at trial. That's not how Mr. Jackson characterized it during his testimony. That's not how the other DMC insiders characterized it during their testimony. Almost everyone, until the defense filed their opening brief, characterized the victims in this case as investors. And this isn't a breach of contract case. This is a fraud case.
Everybody says invest in your future. Give us $60,000 a year in tuition as an investment in your future. And sometimes it's an investment, and sometimes it's a bad one, and sometimes it isn't at all.
Indeed, and part of that is that you know what it's going to. You know if you're investing that money into tuition, you're investing it in higher education.
Let me continue the higher education analogy for a while. When somebody funds research at a university, they give a grant to a university for research, they know perfectly well that 50% of it goes to what's called an overhead, the president's mansion, the servants, the catered events, the flying around, the conferences. Stanford became famous for 60% overhead, which included flowers every day at the president's mansion. I'm having trouble seeing the difference, except that the university discloses that they take a 50% or 60% overhead on research grants. Was there a lie in this case about how much the overhead was going to be?
Your Honor, I don't think it was discussed at all, actually. I think the way that I would
consume it for fraud, there has to be a lie.
Well, I think material omissions are also actionable.
If there's a fiduciary duty ordinarily, for example, if I say, can I borrow $500 from you, and I omit that I'm going to use it for gambling, which jeopardizes my ability to pay it back, that's not fraud. If I say, can I borrow $500 from you to make my car payment, and I actually use it for gambling, then it's fraud because I lied. I told the car payment lie. Since I don't have a fiduciary duty to you, if I just say, can I borrow $500, and I don't mention what I'm using it for, there's no fraud. And I'm trying to figure out how this case is different.
Well, Your Honor, I think the cases say that once you decide to speak and make a statement, that you can't omit things that make that statement false.
I thought the evidence showed that Mr. Jackson told to his investors that all of their money would be used for real estate investments or words to that effect. Is that incorrect?
No, it's not, Your Honor. And some of them,
there is a lie.
That's the lie. Right.
Give me the excerpts of records.
Your Honor, I would go specifically, and different investors said it differently, and so you could look at, but what I would look at specifically for the way it was supposed to work is William Major's testimony, and I can provide that to the court. He was a DMC insider, and you can look at, starting at SER 253 to 254, 57, 61, 287, 290, and 294. The way that it was supposed to work, as people who didn't know what Jackson was doing with the money said, was that investor money came into the Genesis bank account, and then the money went to Koa Weaver to be invested in land and real estate. And then the profits were from that was then shared back to the investment club and then went to the specific.
William Majors is the guy testifying about the scheme, and I think he's one of the ones that took a plea deal. Is that right?
He is not, Your Honor. Mr. Major was the one who actually did some of the technical, some of the victims took their money out from IRAs and retirement funds and things like that, and he did the paperwork with Entrust.
Okay, what I'm looking for here is a statement from one of the lenders about what lie he was told or what statement he was told that without some additional information purchase would have amounted to a false or deceptive statement.
Well, the reason, and I can provide that, the reason why I provided Mr. Majors, he actually sat in on a lot of the presentations where Jackson made representations to the investors.
Yeah, I understand. I'm just trying to find why.
So I would look to the testimony of both Vera McLean And Byron McLean was specifically asked, you know, if he did something else with your money, would that have mattered? He said, no, he was promised that the money would be invested in land and in real estate. Maybell, John Molster, all of the victims made similar misstatements or similar statements that was what they were told. And it was remarkable in the fact that most of them didn't know each other, that the statements were pretty much all the same, and indeed
couldn't all be invested in real estate because any business enterprise has overhead.
Your Honor, some of the victims made statements that they did anticipate that some small de minimis amount might go to overhead, might go to expenses, but not this. And if you look at, if you construe the evidence in the light most favorable to the government, as this court must do under Nevels, I think the evidence is more than sufficient. I would also, just to answer the court's question about the $2.5 million that was invested in real estate, the government did not prove that much was invested in real estate. That was a very conservative number as far as Mr. Jackson, and that is specifically in the record at 545, that it was a conservative amount. And so was the 10.3, and that's in the record at SCR 515. The government gave Mr. Jackson the benefit of every doubt. And when you look at the enterprise as a whole, and you remember what this was really about, this was an umbrella Ponzi scheme with Mr. Bolin at the top and little Ponzi schemes going out from there. And Mr. Jackson actually taught individuals how to do this.
The big problem with the Ponzi scheme language that you've used is Ponzi didn't buy any postal coupons, and these people did invest in real estate.
So for that, Your Honor, I would refer the court to United States versus Munoz, which was cited in the government's brief, and that was the case with the bus shelters where defendants sold bus shelters to investors and then leased them back. It was supposed to do advertisements, and then they did that for a while, and then I think as many Ponzi schemes happen, most people don't just set out to rob people blind and do nothing with the money. I think most Ponzi schemes happen based on just a survey of the case law that they try investments, they go bad, and then you start paying off prior investors with new investor money to try to make it until it works out, and then you just fall into a deeper and deeper hole. You know, this is an example of where that happened, where there was...
And at some point it quits being a Ponzi scheme and just becomes an unsuccessful business.
Well, and the expectation when it's an unsuccessful business is you don't tell investors that the water's fine and that it's a successful business venture, that you don't have all the trappings of success, that you don't tell victims that you're a moneymaker, that you've never missed a payment. I mean, it was true, for example, and this is why it's a fraud case, that for a long time, Mr. Jackson didn't miss a payment to his investors. The false statement or the misrepresentation or the omission there is that he was using new investor money to make sure that he didn't miss those payments, and that's why it's fraud. And if you look at the case as a whole, there is evidence of how much DMC took in from all investors, and that's in the record, and that's $36 million. Mr. Bolden got 20 years in prison. Other individuals got pretty long prison sentences for what happened. This was a massive Ponzi scheme, and the reason why we focused on Mr. Jackson and the Genesis bank account is because until we got to sentencing where there's a different standard for the loss amount and the reasonable expectation of foreseeability and all of the rest, we just held him responsible for what he took into Genesis and what he did with that money. And if you look at the testimony of William Major and Eric Arceo, they were clear that if Mr. Jackson did with the money, what the government's evidence said he did with the money, the investors had no security at all.
Did you have a particular lie as opposed to investors saying what they thought would be done with the money?
So there were a few lies. There was what the investors thought were told he would do with their money. He told investors that their money would be invested in land and real estate. I look at SCR 10.
Before was, you said two investors said they thought the money would be invested in real estate except for negligible amounts. But that's not saying that Jackson told them that.
I would look at SCR 10. SCR 58, SCR 99, SCR 335, SCR 408. I mean, John Maltzner, and this is in the government's brief, he testified that the entire presentation was that we buy land. That was the central theme of the investment. And it was important to investors. I think from that, there are... But he bought a negligible amount. I mean, this isn't a case, for example, where Genesis Innovations had a huge reserve bank account with money just waiting to be spent. I think if the court looks at, for example, the testimony of Tara Cook, and indeed the testimony of Mr. Jackson.
Cook was the FBI.
She is.
Our witness, basically, the accountant.
She's the one who showed what happened with money. She testified because there was a big deal made of LIFO analysis last in, first out. She testified at one point that even if she had used FIFO to analyze the bank account, there would have been no real difference.
That's all meaningless. LIFO and FIFO are inventory accounting methods used in order to value the inventory of a business. They're occasionally applied in criminal cases to funds in order to determine who should get restitution, when, for how much. But it's meaningless in terms of deciding whether loans to a business entity were obtained by fraud. There would indeed be nothing wrong with it if you had an honest business that paid salesmen 20% commission, so when a salesman got raised $100,000, he got to keep 20 of it for himself and give 80 to the entity that employed him as a salesman, unless he lied and told the people who furnished the 100 that all but his $2,000 commission goes to the entity, or his sales load is only 2% or something like that.
Well, I respectfully disagree. I think if you're trying to...
For example, when you buy a mutual fund from a stockbroker, you may ask him, what do you get on this, and what's the load on the fund, and he can't lie to you about that. But as long as he doesn't, he's fine taking the money off the top.
Well, I respectfully disagree that LIFO and FIFO are irrelevant because it establishes what actually happened with the money that came into the Genesis Innovations bank account. And when you have money coming in, a new $295,000 investment, and there's only approximately a $6,000 balance, and then the money goes out the way that the government's evidence showed it went out over and over and over again, that's fraud. There's no question about the bank's current inventory or any of the rest of it, because there's no real money in the account at that
point. Let me bring you back. You started with the devils. We're on a sufficiency of the evidence. So we have to say whether a reasonable juror could decide, taking the evidence in the light most favorable to the government. But what is our task here under a sufficiency standard?
Well, it's to determine whether any reasonable juror could have viewed this evidence in the light most favorable to the government and found guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. And I think...
That Mr. Jackson participated in a scheme to defraud because he fraudulently told them all the money was going to real estate.
Yes. Or that his representations were false and fraudulent and that he had the intent to defraud. And I think relevant to the hypotheticals that are presented to the defense, I would turn to the central premise of Neville's room, or one of them. And it's that, and I see I have 5 seconds left. Can I finish the next sentence? It's that the government does not need to rebut all reasonable interpretations of the evidence that would establish the defendant's innocence or rule out every hypothesis except that of guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. If there are any further questions.
Thank you.
Thank you, Your
Honor.
First, there's no case that I'm aware of where tracing LIFO, FIFO, or anything like that, the loan is enough to support criminality. The government's effort here is to make a very broad statute, far, far broader than it already is. Two, the indictment rests on the question of how much money was invested with KOA Weaver and Sycamore Ventures. There was no effort to explore that issue. There's a chart here, page 9 of the government's brief, Exhibit 2, but there's no similar chart that deals with the actual realistic situation of KOA Weaver and Sycamore Ventures.
for all the evidence that the government provided. This case is just like Eclectic Properties East versus Marcus and Millichap, where a legitimate business enterprise was caught up in a terrible real estate market in 2007. This court said, as a matter of law, it was insufficient. Three, the evidence in this case, in terms of the spending, is perfectly consistent. Mr. Jackson's spending with the government's position that he was the closer, the rainmaker, it's perfectly understandable that he spent a lot of money on business entertainment of potential investors. And finally, I just want to say, in addition to our request for to dismiss the case because the evidence is insufficient, I don't want to let it go unnoted that Mr. Jackson, even if you disagree with that, is entitled to a new trial because the government rested on theories which did not, in fact, constitute violations of the wire fraud statute. Thank you.
Thank you. Submitted and will next hear argument in Labrador v. Chartist Property and 21st Century.